Hey, what's up? Hope you're doing well today. Thank you so much for tuning in. If this is your first time or first time in a long time, I just want to say how grateful I am that you're joining us today. And I would love it if you would fill out the Connect form to connect with us. We'd love to tell you more about why Summit Church is the place to be. Now, I want to let you in all on a little secret project I've been working on that I think will change our lives, okay? It's called You Choose It. And it would revolutionize the way we live our lives. Now, the basic premise is that we have to make decisions every day of our lives. And at some point, we will face decision fatigue. Have you heard of this? Decision fatigue is the difficulty in making a good decision experienced as a result of the number of decisions we have to make. Now, we've all been there, right? Like, you just get to the point where even the simplest decision becomes incredibly difficult because we've just reached this point where we no longer have the mental and emotional space to make a decision. That's where you insert You Choose, a device that will make all of the decisions you need to make. Trying to decide if you should hit the snooze button again? Just ask You Choose. Wondering if you should come up with a lame excuse to get out of that date with someone? Ask You Choose. Oh no, your husband asked you to watch a sports game with him, but you would rather catch up on Love is Blind. Just ask, You Choose. Stuck in traffic? Do you off-road it, pull over, or camp out, or start weaving in and out of the lanes like you're the only one that's trying to get somewhere? No sweat, You Choose has you covered. Now, okay. I haven't really been dreaming this up, but now that I've said this out loud, I can see the appeal of it. Because if we're all just being honest, if we're all would confess a little bit, our whole life is basically spent making decisions and living out the blessing or pain of those decisions. So it'd be nice to get some help in making them, right? Did you know that according to researchers at Cornell University, the average adult makes about 35,000 remotely conscious decisions each day? I mean, that's a lot of decisions, if you ask me. Decisions about when to get up and if and when to take a shower, what to wear, when to leave, how much to pay for something, what to buy, work decision, family decision, friend decisions, decisions about eating, which, by the way, of those 35,000 decisions, researchers estimated that 226.7 of them are based on food alone. And I believe it based on my first few months as part of the team here at Summit. It's really all Jesus and food. That seems to be the majority of the conversations around here. But here's the thing, we have to make a lot of decisions. And most of the time, we're not even sure if we're making the best decisions or the wisest decisions. And on top of that, who gets to determine whether a decision or choice we've made is a good choice or a wise choice? Like, who owns the foundational basis for good or bad, wise or unwise, fruitful or unfruitful? If this is your first time here or first time in a long time, we began a new series of messages last week called Origins of Redemption, where we are talking about the themes we find in the first book of the Bible known as Genesis and how those themes can be traced through the rest of the scriptures. As I mentioned last week, our hope is to inspire you to either take your first step into reading the Bible or your next step into understanding the Bible more clearly. Now, last week, and I encourage you to go back and watch it, we looked at the theme of creation and how if God said it was good, then good it will always be. Today, I want to explore the themes of trees and choices. Now, last week, we left off with God saying that all he had created was good, and he took pleasure and delight in all he had done. And on the sixth day of creation, God decided to create the first human man and named him Adam, which in the language of the first century meant soil or earth. Now, soil was taken from the earth and formed into man, but he was not yet fully man, fully in the image of God until the creator breathed breath into his nostrils, bringing this formless and chaotic soil into the fullness and form of man. God then takes the man and places him in the garden called Eden, likely the most beautiful garden ever to be planted on the earth. And we can assume that Eden was bright and beautiful based on the writer telling us that God planted all kinds of trees. And we can easily deduce that if we have all kinds of colorful plants today, very likely they existed back then as well. So God puts Adam in the garden with the sole purpose of tending to it and watching over it. It's now the responsibility of humanity to take care of what God has created. And in the midst of the garden, we're told that God planted or cultivated two specific trees, the tree of life and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Now, right before God creates woman, he gives man some specifics about the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Here's what he tells Adam. He says, "You may freely eat the fruit of every tree in the garden, except the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. If you eat its fruit, you are sure to die." Now, if you're sitting here watching this and reading this verse and wondering, why in the world would God put a tree in the garden that they can't eat from, but then tell them that the tree exists? Then you would be in great company, as this has been a question that has captivated the thoughts of Jesus' followers for centuries. Like, on one hand, many would say that God is God and he can do whatever he wants, right? But others would say that it's cruel to tempt us and then hold us accountable for our choices. So, in order for us to understand why, we have to remember the context I mentioned last week when I talked about this doctrine or set of beliefs about creation. It's as simple as, because God created everything, God is the only one who can determine what is good and what is evil. Now, here's the other side of this question. God wants a real relationship with us, real love. And real love, by its very nature, cannot be forced. God will never force us to love him back. He will woo, but he will never force. His love for us is real. But for our love for him to be real also, it has to be a free choice. We have to choose him. In order for us to choose him, there must be an alternative option. So he didn't place the tree in the garden to tempt us, but to remind us that our love for him is freely chosen. God didn't want blindly obedient robots or slaves. He wanted children. And just like our children, we choose to love or reject our father. And that choice came down to which tree was more appealing to us. Here's what I mean. We don't have a lot of information about the tree of life. But what we do know is that this tree's fruit would give eternal life to those who ate from it. Now, there's nowhere in the scriptures that tell us humans couldn't eat from it, but it would seem correct to assume that Adam and Eve have yet to eat from it until they deal with the other tree and its implications. The tree of life was both real and symbolic at the same time. It's symbolic of the fact that God was and is the source of all eternal life and blessing. To access this tree, Adam and Eve would have to center their lives on God. But this is not the only time we read of this tree. Almost 1,000 years after the writings of Genesis, we read in the writings of a priest named Ezekiel, whose nation had been exiled and taken captive in Babylon. And one of the visions God gives him, he sees this river that flows. And out of this river, he sees these trees. And here is what he writes. "Fruit trees of all kinds will grow along both sides of the river. The leaves of these trees will never be brown or fall, and there will always be fruit on their branches. There will be a new crop every month, for they are watered by the river flowing from the temple. The fruit will be for food and the leaves for healing." Now, the people in Ezekiel's time were living in captivity. All that they knew as life and blessing was turned into despair and hopelessness. So this vision is God showing Ezekiel that they wouldn't live in despair and hopelessness forever. And what does he use to illustrate this point? He references these trees that produce fruit of physical and spiritual sustenance. Ezekiel would have been familiar with this because of the context from Genesis. He would have immediately known that these trees represent the blessing and joy of all that is good that can only come from God. That's the tree of life. Now, that's one tree. How about the other tree? The tree of knowledge of good and evil was similar to the rest of the trees in that its fruit was pleasant to the sight and good for food. However, God deemed that this tree's fruit was off limits, not because it was poisonous or toxic. Remember, everything God created was good. He deemed it off limits because he knew that if chosen, it would destroy their innocence and their purity, introduce shame and guilt, and bring about death into their lives. Remember when God said to Adam that if they were to eat of this fruit, they would surely die? Well, this is God clearly and directly stating the rules of engagement and the consequences of disregarding those rules. I remember when I was about 5 or 6 years old, and I was so curious about electrical sockets in the house. You see, I would watch Saturday morning cartoons and see all these people, and they would stick a fork or a cat tail or something into these sockets, and they would get electrocuted and still live. So I would try to replicate this, but my mom would always catch me and stop me before I could. And I would get so mad, like I wanted to be like those cartoons I watched. Over and over again, I would try. My mom would stop me and spank me and tell me that I could kill myself. Finally, one day, I was able to plot out the exact moment I'd be able to try this. So I grabbed the fork, waited for my opportunity, and as soon as the coast was clear, I stuck it in the socket. Now, as you can tell, because I'm here, I didn't die. But it was not the most pleasant feeling one could have. Not only did I blow the fuse box and almost caught the apartment on fire and blacked out, but apparently you can lose control of bodily functions. And I may have soiled myself in the process. And I'll never forget what my mom said to me after checking to make sure I was okay. She said, "Well, boy, you had a choice to make and you chose wrong. Maybe now you'll listen to me." You see, in that moment after God gives Adam the warning, it can be assumed that Adam knew that obeying God was good and disobeying him was bad. But he had no real experiential understanding of death because he had never seen it. All he knew so far was life and its goodness. So here he is with a choice presented to him and Eve as well. Choose God and all of his goodness and live forever in relational community with the Creator, or choose their own way and face a death they couldn't imagine. And can I tell you that this has been the choice that every single human has had to make? Choose God or choose self. Live by God's designation of good or decide for ourselves what is good and what is evil. That's the representation we have in the choices between the two trees, the tree of life or the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. One invites life and goodness, the other invites evil and death to take place. And it's a choice we've constantly and consistently gotten wrong, time and time again. I mean, all you have to do is look no further than the accounts we read in the rest of scriptures of people choosing self, choosing their own way, and inviting evil and death into their lives. How about this? Think about it in terms of today and the choices we're making in the world now. Because of the curse of sin, we're still choosing evil and death. We're still choosing to distort the image of God that we all bear by harming people, by harming ourselves, by changing, abusing, and using our bodies in ways God never intended. When we sin, when we choose to lie to our spouses or flirt with that married man or woman and think that no one will get hurt or let the anger get the best of us, putting our hands on our kids or our spouses, allow hate to drive our affections for one another, allow money to be our God when we cheat, steal, kill, lust. I mean, you name it. We are all over again choosing our own way of evil and death over God's way of life and goodness. Any Mandalorian fans watching today? Every time I see this brokenness or this sin in myself or in others, I'm reminded of when the Mandalorian's way of basically saying amen, they would say, "This is the way," right? But I'm saying, this isn't the way. This isn't the way God wanted it for you and me. He had something so much better planned for us. However, the choice is presented to Adam and Eve, and as we're about to see, they choose to go their own way. So in Genesis 3, the writer writes, "The serpent was the shrewdest of all wild animals the Lord God had made. And one day he asked the woman, 'Did God really say you must not eat the fruit from any of the trees in the garden?'" Now, the writer of this moment wants us to see that this serpent is to be identified with the devil, Satan, the enemy. You see, Satan simply is a really good deceiver who's been doing it since the very beginning. He's hell-bent on destroying all that God deemed good. And one of the ways he has gone about this is through counterfeiting. Like, there is no originality to Satan because he's a created thing. Let me put it this way. What God creates, Satan counterfeits. You see, God gave us Fruity Pebbles, right? Satan counterfeits with Trix. God gave us Pringles. Satan counterfeits with veggie sticks. God gave us the beautiful nectar of Coca-Cola. Satan counterfeits with Pepsi. Disgusting, right? Now, if you work at any of those brands, are those your favorite brands? I'm sorry, but I just gotta make a point. Those are not good. You see, what God creates, Satan counterfeits. God gives the Holy Spirit, and Satan counterfeits with unholy spirits known as demons. God creates renewal and revival, and Satan counterfeits with confusion and chaos. God calls people to turn from their destructive behaviors and false ideology because he loves us. Satan counterfeits with affirmation of destructive behaviors and false ideology because he hates us. You see, God defines good to give us life in abundance, and Satan tells us to define good to bring death in abundance. God creates and deserves our trust, and Satan counterfeits with distrust. And that's what he's doing here. He's trying to create distrust between humanity and God. He begins with this low-key, innocent-sounding invitation to set in judgment on what God has said. And this was an attempt to get Eve in Adam to doubt God's word. Here's how Eve responds. She says, "Of course we may eat from the fruit of the trees in the garden." The woman replied, "It's only the fruit from the tree in the middle of the garden that we are not allowed to eat. God said, you must not eat it or even touch it. If you do, you will die." Now, here's a small yet interesting note. God does tell Adam and Eve not to eat from one of the trees, the tree of knowledge of good and evil, in the middle of the garden, right? But we have no record of him saying anything about touching it. And because of this slight deviation and exaggeration of God's command, we see the birth of false religion. Constructing a set of rules around God's command that goes beyond or otherwise deviates from what he said. The serpent is painting God as this killjoy, and Eve's deviation and exaggeration of God's command will result in a wedge of mistrust between God and his human creatures. "You won't die," the serpent replied to the woman. "God knows that your eyes will be open as soon as you eat it, and you will be like God, knowing both good and evil." Now, can I just tell you something? This is a blatant lie, but it's a juicy lie because it's partnered with the idea that God's words are subjective to our judgment, and we have the ability to determine its meaning. It also includes the half-truth that she will be like God. Now, I can imagine them standing there thinking that maybe God didn't know what was best for them. I mean, how can a good, loving, caring God who claims to have made us in his image withhold from us something good like this fruit? What's so special about the tree of knowledge of good and evil anyways? Why doesn't God trust us with it? Does that mean that he doesn't love us as much as he said he does? So they decide at that moment to choose for themselves. Here's what the writer continues to say. "The woman was convinced she saw that the tree was beautiful and its fruit looked delicious, and she wanted the wisdom it would give her. So she took some of the fruit and ate it. Then she gave some of to her husband who was with her, and he ate it too." Now, there are two things that really stick out about this moment. First, in another translation of this, it says that Eve saw that the tree was good. Now, doesn't this sound awfully familiar? Remember, as God was creating, he would say and determine that his creation was good. Now here's Eve usurping God's authority and deciding on the basis of their own judgment what is to be considered good and what is to be counted as evil. She made the conscious choice to take the place of God and upturn the creation order. In Genesis 1, God is the one who determines what is considered good and what is counted as evil. But then in Genesis 3, Eve reverses that. Eve and Adam reverse that. And Eve and Adam are on top. They choose to replace God with themselves as the ultimate determiner of what is good and what is evil. Eve has rearranged the pieces, and now she is sitting at the apex of the triangle, sitting in judgment over what God and the serpent said to her. Here's the other thing. It's the deafening silence that's coming from Adam, who had, as the writer describes, been with her. He has said nothing, nor has he sought to intervene at any point, not to correct the serpent, not to help Eve, not to refuse the offered fruit. And all of this despite the command not to eat of the tree being given directly and explicitly to him. His silence speaks eloquently of his complicity in the sin. Two people with one choice usher evil and death into creation, into a creation it was never intended to enter upon. This choice of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, or the tree of testing, as it's also known, also introduces us to this concept of the noble lie. You see, the noble lie is a falsehood told by an individual or a group in power with the aim of manipulating those under their power into doing what otherwise they would not do, often with the veneer of a noble purpose. You see, on the surface, Satan wants Eve to reach her full potential and not to be held back by some arbitrary rules God has made. Satan feeds Eve a false dream and encourages her to follow her dreams. But in reality, Eve and eventually Adam are slavishly doing the bidding of Satan and violating their own best interests, hence the noble lie. They believe Satan's lie, and they think that their good is in becoming like God and knowing good and evil, whereas Satan knows that that lie will destroy them but please him. But notice how God deals with them after their choice. He tells them uncomfortable things, hard things, things that may cause us to wonder why he's acting as is, why he puts the tree in the garden to begin with. But he never lies to Adam and Eve, not even for their own good. Later in the Bible, we see that those who would speak for God never tricked the people into believing something that is untrue in order to get them to follow God, even if following God would save their lives. God never hides the pain of sin or the need of repentance. Hell, the hell we bring on earth, is hard, but is not hidden. Suffering is severe, but it is not shrouded. God has been clear about the choice to follow our own way. And let me tell you, it's a truth that doesn't change depending on your circumstances. God's truth is true regardless of who you are, whether you're a child or adult, whether you're black, white, Asian, or Hispanic, rich or poor, American or Cuban, married or single, gay or straight, urban or suburban. God's truth is one size fit all. So Adam and Eve choose to reject the life of goodness that comes only from God, and now must be exiled from the garden so that they will no longer have access to the tree of life. I mean, this is the consequences of their choices. They wanted to be like God, deciding what is considered good and what is counted as evil. And their reward was death, not immediate, but a slow death that was both spiritual and eventually physical. This moment is later referenced in a letter to Jesus' followers living in Rome, written by a guy named Paul. He tells them that for the wages of sin is death. You see, Paul is pointing out that death, both physical and spiritual, is the direct result of the choice in the garden. It is a direct result of the fact that we continue to make the same choice over and over again today. When we choose our own way, when we choose to usurp God's declaration of what is considered good and what counts as evil, when we believe in the noble lie, we are inviting that evil and death to continue as is without intervention and without interference. But can I tell you, this isn't the way. It isn't. God didn't intend for evil and death to be the definitions of his creation. So in his perfect and good plans, he made a way for us to re-choose. Paul would go on to say, but the free gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus, our Lord. Now, I don't want to spoil the upcoming weeks of this series. Our teaching minister, Kaylee Newker, is going to walk us through some hard and some of the coolest themes we find in Genesis. But I do want to point out this final theme of the trees and choices. You see, this is not the last time we're going to see this tree of testing, the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Adam and Eve are tempted and they choose to determine for themselves what is good and what to be counted as evil. But God will use another tree to undo their doing once and for all. This is the free gift Paul is referring to, that when we choose Jesus, we are aligning ourselves with the better choice, the right choice, the choice Adam and Eve should have made from the beginning. One choice at a tree brought death and evil. Another choice on a tree brings about salvation and life. So let me ask you, where are you choosing what you know God doesn't want for you right now? Like, how are you treating your spouse and kids? What are you looking at or watching? How about the relationships you're surrounding yourself with? Are you mean to people, even if you use the Bible to defend being mean? Are you choosing money over Sabbath rest? Are you sitting in judgment of people who didn't vote the same as you? Are you putting the law over people? Are you putting people over the law? Are you withholding your treasures from God because you don't trust the church? Are you withholding your heart from God because you don't think He's worthy enough? We all have a choice because God wants children, not robots. He wants lovers, not slaves. Let me ask you, what will you choose? And maybe today you need to choose Jesus. Maybe you're watching this and you're saying, you know what, Michael? I've been making the wrong choice. Well, let me tell you, all you have to do is admit that you've been living a life apart from God, a life where you've chosen death and destruction over goodness and life. Admit that, and then believe that Jesus died for you, that He came back, He rose from the dead, and He wants to save you. And choose today to say yes to Jesus. I just want to tell you that if you made that decision today, the angels in heaven rejoice, God rejoices, we rejoice, and we would love to connect with you. So fill out that connect form, let us know, and one of our pastors will reach out to you. Let me pray for you. Jesus, we're so grateful that you provided us a second chance to choose again life and hope in you. Lord, may we choose this day to follow you forever. We pray this in Jesus' name, and the house said, I can see your heart and everything you've made.
Where God creates, the devil counterfeits. This message is a clear reminder that, of course, that the Lord in his creation, he had some original intent for us. But of course, the enemy got in the way, and now, even in modernity, humanity is getting in the way where we put our own choices before the Lord's. But as Michael reminded us, when we do choose to follow what the Lord has for us, that is where we find peace and love, and that's where most of our life is actually life-giving. Thank you, Michael, for that sweet reminder.
And if you're already subscribed here on our YouTube channel, we would love for you to go find us on Facebook and Instagram and follow along with us over there, because we were putting out all sorts of great content that is specifically created to help you deepen your relationship with God. But that's all we have for you guys today, and we so look forward to seeing you next week.